The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus said, "To what will I compare this generation? It is like children sitting in the marketplaces and calling to one another. We played the flute for you and you did not dance. We wailed and you did not mourn. For John came neither eating nor drinking, and they say, he has a demon. The Son of Man came eating and drinking, and they say, look, a glutton and a drunkard, a friend of tax collectors and sinners. Yet wisdom is vindicated by her deeds." At that time, Jesus said, "I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and the intelligent and have revealed them to infants. Yes, Father, for such was your gracious will. All things have been handed over to me by my Father, but no one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son chooses to reveal him. Come to me, all you that are weary and carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Please be seated.
There's a somewhat old adage that I've probably mentioned at least a couple times here. And it was the bumper sticker, I think, or maybe not, but the adage is, whether you think you can or you think you can't, you're probably right. Whether you think you can do something or whether you think you can't do something, you're probably right. And that's important for us to remember, because a lot of times we convince ourselves that we're not able to do things because of fear or because of lack of preparation or because of whatever it might be. And yet we also know that the moment that we try and commit ourselves to being and doing the thing that we try to do, while we may not be wildly successful, we will probably achieve something close to what we were hoping to achieve. And a little piece of self-disclosure, and I know that everybody here has probably heard this also. While I was in seminary, I was blessed to have the opportunity to be the chaplain at Children's Hospital in Washington, D.C. And that was a very memorable time for me. But it was also a time where I said, I don't want to deal with sick children because that's really scary for me and I don't do sick children. And it was very memorable for me, though, in ways which are hard to describe. There were some very deep reasons, experiences of death, and intimately walking with people who weren't like me and learning about people's faith and traditions which are not my own. And of course, memorable for amazing reasons. Sitting with a little kid who had drawn a picture and was trying to point out, "Don't you see the angels in this picture?" And I was baffled because I couldn't. And she said, "They're right there behind the rainbow." And I was like, "Of course, they're behind the rainbow." Or sitting on the floor with a six-year-old as he tries to tell me about how he talks with God. And as simply as I am talking to you, or we might be talking to each other. And of course, again, this was all while we're playing with cars and I'm sitting on the floor in his room. In that moment, I learned a lot about the reality of faith and the faith in community. That experience in the Children's Hospital was an opportunity to learn about the nuts and bolts of relating with others, especially in a high-stress environment. Some people, some of my classmates, struggled there partly because of their temperament. They were either ill-suited for the exact environment that they found themselves in and hadn't had any preparation or done any deep thought, or they were just simply not able to set themselves aside to learn about their profession. And it's not so much a failing as it is a missed opportunity. However, knowing the principles of being chaplain provided a base of knowledge that I could build on, but those principles couldn't thrive simply in my head. They had to be put into practice. They had to be put into life so that I might understand and gain understanding about who I am and who I am in God's kingdom and how God operates in the lives of others. And as me and my classmates traversed our time at the hospital, we realized God's grace was the only thing that allowed us to be effective for God and to heal those in need. So where today do we find ourselves as we continue to learn about our faith as a church and as individuals? How are we invited to trust that God's grace will in fact be all that we need to survive? And what is our place in God's story in the here and now, not in that time back there, not in that time that lies ahead someplace, but in this present moment, in the here and now? And probably more importantly, what does Scripture say to us as we continue on our journey? Well, in the gospel reading today, we see Jesus addressing society and trying to help them make sense of what they've been told in their life, how to measure their success and how to determine what is good and right in God's kingdom. And ironically, or maybe not, because we know this is Jesus, and Jesus sometimes doesn't speak very directly, Jesus addresses the nebulous this generation, or this present generation. Maybe this is something that each successive generation may have to realize and re-examine itself against the true relationship with God, both in their personal lives and in community, that Jesus is setting out for them. In the story, Jesus identifies two groups, children and Pharisees. And we don't learn Pharisees until a little bit later in the story, but that's understood by us this side of the story. The children are portrayed as playful, expectant, able to be taught and willing to learn, while the Pharisees are portrayed as judgmental, dismissive of those who are different than them, discounting what they see, and rely upon themselves because they are people who know how things must work, and they know how things really work in the world. The children described by Jesus are ones that interact with others, participate with expectation and a sense of awe in God's presence. They're the ones who want to come up and touch Jesus and be with him. The Pharisees are one that want to hold Jesus at arm's length and say, "You aren't what we expect." Those who will participate are the children, and they trust in God's grace. Those dismissive Pharisees discount Jesus and the experience of the faithful that is among them, and those who are in awe of God's presence and Jesus also. They dismiss God's representatives because they know what God does, how God works, and how God will act. And Jesus and John in this story aren't acting in the right and proper way. The reality that we experience today is that we are invited to come to know this true power that comes in the sense of awe found in the child and the one who lets themselves be surprised. But part of our difficulty as humans is the experiences that we have and how those experiences might bring contempt upon us and corrupt us as people who are children of God. Sometimes we allow those experiences to temper our reactions. And yes, we need to understand that our reactions can be useful in some ways. the reactions that we have to others are sometimes self-protective, because we realize that not everybody is willing to look out for the other in their midst. So there are people out there, amazing as it might seem, that they don't trust that God will in fact provide the things that they need to be successful in ways which further God's kingdom. But our reactions that we have and the contempt and the skepticism that we feel can distance us from others and from where we and they are and they find themselves. Sometimes we feel that we are skeptical, and probably rightly so, and being burned can cause us to question why God doesn't act like we think God should act. And we catch ourselves, hopefully, asking those questions and then answering, thankfully, I'm not God. So how are we invited to go and move today? Well, God asks us to surrender our skepticism, to return to our dependence upon God's grace, and to approach God with awe and wonder, and expect to be surprised, because God will, in fact, do what God promises. God invites us to approach with awe and possibility, because, yes, in fact, there are angels behind the rainbow drawn on the board, on the piece of paper. And yes, talking to God is as simple as a six-year-old sitting on the floor pushing around cars implies. All we have to do is simply be present for God. God continues to ask us to check our bias, to ask ourselves what would happen if things didn't work like we know that they do, and help and actually work the way that God promises they will. God asks us to depend upon God's grace for guidance and the direction, because true power is only available in God's grace. So what does it mean for us as we continue on this journey? We need to remember that we have grace inside us, which is waiting to lead us to the place where God has prepared for us to be amazed and enriched. God's grace is with us at all times and in all places. And by trusting in God's grace, we will find the people who will celebrate with and alongside us as they continue on their journey. God puts amazing people in our midst who will help us get over those things which hinder our grace-filled life of faith. God will put people committed to being the difference in our community and in our church in the midst of us. All that God asks us to do is to trust that they will be there and welcome them with open arms and a trusting heart. We are invited to remember that the simplicity of life of a child is one that believes in magic and the real presence of God. People that God will put in the midst of our lives are the ones which will help us remember that God is really here with us today and forever. So what are we invited to do by God? To remember the law and how and what someone tells us to do will not save us, but it will, in fact, sometimes bring us closer to God or remind us of the shortcomings that we have. The demands that we have on our lives in God's kingdom are to approach with awe, to do good, and to eliminate evil. And we should be prepared to approach with awe and to be surprised that God really acts the way that God has promised. Forever and forever. We need to be focused on being connected to our community so that all may thrive together. God is with us in the simplicity of life, and if we trust that God will lead us, we will realize that God has been leading us all along, today and forever. Amen.
Amen.